tester.co.uk.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to part 2 of this review on the Vici and the Victor VC97. Now, as you know, just as I ended off on the last one, I gave the Victor a shake and there's something loose inside it. I don't know whether it's just a piece of plastic or something untoward, but we're basically going to start off by taking these apart, having a look at the insides, and then we'll test the battery consumption, the low battery warning level, and then we'll do a mains test of them. And we'll see, I've heard some bad stories of if you make changes on the dial while taking a mains measurement, and we'll make that call on the bench whether we do that, but it might be worthwhile doing just so we know if there is a risk with using these on mains and making the adjustment. What can go wrong? It says you shouldn't make a change while you've got something connected, but it might be worthwhile checking that out. Let's get down to the bench and have a look inside. Right then, so I've got them side by side, and what I'm going to do for the first part of the shoot, I'm going to leave the video at normal speed so that you can see me take off the kind of covers and get into the battery housings just to see what that looks like. And then I'll time lapse as I pull them both apart and get them both open, and then we'll take a closer look at the insides. So let's start with the Vici. It's obviously got this holster. Let's have a look at that. Let's have a look at the rest of it. Oh, as I said, the quality of the standing bail, not the best. It has a holster. Look, it feels a little cheapy, but not too bad, I suppose. Again, for the price, can't really complain. Let's have a look inside the actual battery compartment. Okay, so that opens up easily enough. Ah, interesting. I wasn't expecting to see this. I was expecting to see a 9-volt battery. And again, it's just one of my quirks. I prefer multimeters that run off pen lights or AAA batteries. And it's got these two AAA batteries in this kind of in this battery holder. So that doesn't look too bad. Right, so let's open up the rest of it. Ah, that wasn't too difficult. So that's the back, the shielding they've got on the back of the case. And then the actual board itself. So before I go any further, I'll start now, just get the Victor taken apart. Okay, and again, obviously a cheaper plasticky, rubbery kind of holster, but not too bad. It also doesn't look too bad out of its case. The plastics on both of these, I note, are very cheap in comparison, obviously, with the higher brands. But again, the price point. I'll note, obviously, that on the Vici, obviously, very small self-tapping screws that go into plastic receivers. And that's what I'd expect to see. They're not making it easy on the Victor, that's for sure. Let me just open the battery case, battery opening. That does go into a metal receiver. Straight access to some very perhaps dubious fuses. So what does that say? 400 milliamp. If we look in there, 400 milliamp, and it says at 10 amp, 250 volt. So that's interesting again. So fuses that are rated for 250 volts, yet it's obviously talking about 1000 volts and 750 volts input. I must say, I'm keen with one of these to actually put an insulation tester and shove, let's say, 500 volts through and see what happens. But okay, same arrangement with the kind of battery holder for the AAA batteries. Okay, so that's what was bouncing around inside. It's literally just a spare piece of molded plastic. It doesn't look too serious by all accounts. Now, let's see if I can get the rest of it. I'm really battling with trying to get the screws undone. I cannot get a bigger screwdriver in there, and the smaller one is providing a bit of a challenge. Okay, so it's got larger self-tappers into plastic. These look a bit more robust than the smaller ones that are on the Vichy. There's a little kind of quality sticker or something up here. I'm just gonna slice through it. Okay, well, I can see the first thing that catches my eye. It's got, interesting, that's a first. The shielding in the back is actually a piece of metal sheet. Looks like galvanized metal sheet that's plastic riveted onto the back, and that's where that little plastic came from that was shaking about. You can see there's a piece broken up off there, so obviously just melt the kind of plastic tabs to put the shielding there. Looks like obviously there was room for a piezo speaker, but on both of them, but it doesn't have it. And what I'm noting is the spring, which is supposed to obviously be upright and connecting with the actual shielding, is pressed against the board, and there looks like some really grotty soldering over here. Okay, so let me just put them side by side and just note a few things that I noted straight off. So the first thing that catches my eye is that you do have, although they're not great fuses, you've got accessible fuses on the Victor. But I can't see any fuses obviously on this side of the board or the Vichy, which presumably they're on the other side. But then obviously, even as an end user, if you wanted to change your fuses, you would have to take the screws. So we'll do that now anyway, because we want to have a look and see what's on the other side. At first glance, if I was certainly to look at the quality of the soldering and what have you, the Victor looks a little more grotty in terms of the mess on the board. Yeah, but some of it certainly doesn't look the best. There are the fuses. Let's have a quick look at the Vichy. And it's, I can almost see like water, I suppose there can't be water stains on it, but if I turn this sideways to catch light, I don't know if you can see it on the camera. There we go. Can you see that? Those stains on the, and I presume that's just from the factory or the process of soldering it, but it does look a bit mucky on there as well. I'm going to remove the batteries before I go any further, just so we don't have any mishaps there, and we'll see what's on the other side of the boards. Okay, and just for interest, the batteries that come in the Vichy are these Golden Power heavy duty green energy. I'm sure we've seen those before somewhere. And these HW or I think high watt, here we go. I don't know if you can see that in the camera, HW, and they've got a little note on there that says high watt batteries that come in the Victor. These come out of the Victor. Okay, let's pull the boards out. Right, I thought I'd just pop it down on the bench, so hopefully I can provide a kind of better, more stable view. Let's have a brief look. It's obviously got the cheaper input, banana inputs over here. I say cheaper. They're not split. They are the solid type. And now just a reminder, we are obviously looking at the Vici. It's got its fuses on the inside over here. This is that the kind of auxiliary temperature input for your K-type probe. It has several pots, variable pots, for obviously making the adjustments. So if we really want to adjust the voltage on this or what have you, then we could do. The fuses, does it say? I'm just looking for any writing on the board, but I reckon these will be 250 volt fuses as well. It does have a set of PTCs or poly switches over here on the input for some input protection, but no MOVs. And then on the board over here, you can note it says 3 volts, so that's the input that comes through from the cable from the actual battery connector itself. It then obviously has the liquid crystal display unit, and it'll just obviously have the Zebra board coming down, or the Zebra connector coming down onto the actual board itself. This is obviously the transistor tester, which is stuck up on the board. So fairly simple and straightforward, and fairly cheap looking, but again, I can't be critical because of the price point. It really is cheap, and so you obviously get what you pay for. And I suppose you could get worse, you could open up and find it worse than this, but yeah, this is a quality you're going to expect for around this price point. This is the actual case itself with the selector switch. Interesting arrangement. I can't recall seeing something like this where you've obviously got a selector switch going through with an axle onto the back like this. But this is probably why you get, it does give that kind of cheaper feel, because it will be rather detached in terms of its drive to the actual selector itself. I mean, I can see you've got this very skinny plastic connector, and it just obviously slips and holds in there, and that's why it certainly doesn't give a good feel to the hand when you rotating the selector switch. Okay, then it's obviously got these, this is where the those solid banana inputs go through. Let's have a closer look at the Vici. Okay, so I'll put that on down on the bench so we can have a closer look. So this is the Victor, and obviously, I mean, I didn't mention, but obviously that's the main current shunt. It also has these solid banana receivers on the board.
I'd be still intrigued to know, compare, we'll have a look and compare the length to see why, perhaps we can understand why a standard set of leads don't seem to fit in there. It's got one PTC or poly switch on it as opposed to the two that the Vichy had. The soldering over there, and again I'll try and bring you in a little bit closer, see if we can focus. Doesn't seem to be the best quality. It does also have a set of variable resistors by the looks of it to make adjustments to it. And more than that, they are underneath on this one, they've got a bit more tucked under the display. So they've obviously got some of the more adjustments underneath the actual display itself. And I suppose they might have a bit tucked. They do seem to have a bit more tucked away under there. So let me get that taken off so we can have a look. Before we do that, we'll just quickly have a look at the actual case itself. Has it got a similar arrangement? Interesting. Okay. Not sure how that arrangement works with... Oh, I wonder if... Did some screws go through there? Okay, well, that might add some fun and games to me. Actually, I did hear something drop away. So that might make for a bit of a challenge. This was obviously being held up by screws through the board. So that's certainly going to make for a challenge for getting it back together, but never mind. And then the actual selector switch doesn't come loose as it does with the Vichy, which, as I said, this one seems to have certainly a slightly better feel than the Vichy does, the Victor. There we go, the little bits for the banana sockets have dropped out, no biggie. Let's take the actual displays off and see what's underneath them. Okay, a little bit tricky because the Zebra connector is sticking to the board and pulling the whole display out. I'm going to try and get it so that it sits nicely in its plastic case. There we go. Hopefully we can get that all lined up and working okay. Okay, so there's the LCD in its kind of plastic container with the Zebra connector. It's obviously got the buzzer. Let's bring you in a little bit closer just to see what's on the board. So some more adjustments, some capacitors, diodes, obviously the main underneath the blob, that'll be where the main chip or IC is that runs the meter, and the little very silent or piddly sounding piezo is mounted on the board over there. So there we go, not much more to them. I'll do the same trick on the Vichy so that we can have them side by side. Okay, so that came off a little bit neater. It's kind of more self-contained. It's quite a neat little unit they've got for the LCD, so it is all self-contained and doesn't rattle apart. Yeah. A little bit of a different arrangement with the piezo buzzer as opposed to the hole in the top. It's kind of got an opening on the side here. It's a little different from what I've seen before. It's got a clock, and then obviously the main IC that operates it. So not a huge amount under here. One more variable resistor, variable pot. And that is it. I'll put them side by side just so you can get a comparison. But they certainly seem to be different boards, obviously, and I'm assuming that the technology underneath the blobs is the same because of the functionality, but that's an assumption on my behalf. What I will do, I will take some photographs of the boards themselves, some more high-res photographs, and if you want a closer look, you can obviously go to my forum and have a look there. But next, what I'm going to do, I'm going to put them back together. I'll then power them from my power supply just so we can see the consumption and at what level the low-level battery warning comes on. Right, so what I thought I'd just quickly show you as I'm assembling these, I have on the Vici, I hadn't realized, and you wouldn't realize it when you're kind of undoing things from the top side, but these four screws over here hold the selector arrangement on the board itself. So there we go. You can see that is held separately, and then obviously the case goes on top. I assume the Victor has got a similar arrangement, but at the moment the whole kind of selector arrangement seems to be stuck inside the actual board. So fun and games, when I get to that I'll show you how that hangs together, but I'll get the rest of this together so we can start testing the battery. Right, now I thought I'd just jump in and show you the assembly process of the Victor. The actual selector dial, if you like, it just simply pulls off. You can see the kind of square insert over there, and that's obviously where the selector goes through, so I had to pull it off from this side. It gets placed down. In the process, as I pulled it off, one of these sweeper connectors came out, but they go in easily enough, but they certainly are just sprung in there, so they do come out fairly easy. But this obviously gets put down on the actual printed circuit board, and then this, you have to match up obviously the screw holes and the kind of plastic pointers to go down there, and then obviously you have to hold it down because it's sprung, and then obviously put the screws in. So I'll do that and again put it together so we can continue with the testing. Right, so I've got the Victor VC97 hooked up to my power supply, which is set at 3 volts. I've got my amp probe here so it can measure the current. So as I switch it on, it comes on okay, so at least it survived the kind of pulling apart and putting back together. So it's just using over 1 milliamp. So that certainly seems fairly low current. It obviously, with the two AAA batteries, there's not going to be a huge amount of energy stored in there, but obviously the consumption's not that high. There is no backlight. We'll go and check, for instance, on items, if we put it on the continuity test. So there it goes up to 25.8, but obviously that's not going to be used for a long time. Just out of interest, if we put onto resistance, we're just over a milliamp there, and if we were put it together, just about 1.3. Let's just go through the others quickly, just to make sure nothing jumps out. It drops down at capacitance testing. It'll obviously go up, I assume, once we connect a capacitor. Let's just do that quickly to see what it does use. Right, so I've got my decade capacitor box over here. I'm just going to plug it in and dial in a few values quickly just to see if it does consume. No, I thought it might kick it up a bit higher, but certainly it's not using a lot of current even when testing capacitors. Right, we'll just finish off around the dial, see if anything does jump out. Temperature, okay, it jumps up to 1.8. Microamps, 1.7. No, and then off on the other side. Right, so let's connect up the Vici. Right, same again, 3 volts on the Vici. Power on, just over, slightly less, but about 1 milliamp. Drops down again for capacitance. What we'll do, we'll just quickly connect some leads and see what it does with the continuity buzzer. So much the same, that one's going up to 28.5. Jumps up again for temperature. Microamps, milliamps, amps, much the same. So certainly not very high consumption, but obviously, as I said, you only got two AAA batteries running these. Right, so now we're hooked up, ready to check the low battery warning on these meters. I've got them hooked up to my 5-volt reference, so we want to see whether the readings go far out before the warning comes up. This is the voltage, obviously, that's being supplied by my power supply. I'm going to start turning it down slowly, and we'll note when the actual warning comes on these meters. Right. Whoa, okay. The warning has flipped on both of them at roughly the same time. I don't know if you can see the annotation. Sorry, I know there's a bit of glare on this one over here, but it's over there and on that one over there at about 2.3 volts. So let's just see if we do go lower. Oops, oh my goodness. That certainly starts losing its marbles. Let's just 2.3 come back up. The warnings go away. So below 2.3, they're back. And it looks like I'm going to start drifting now, about 1.7 volts. The Victor totally loses its marbles. The Vici is still going. Yeah, Victor's out, okay, and then they, about 1.4, they drop out. So at least they do show the warning beforehand, but as you can see on these ones, as soon as you see the battery warning, that's the time you want to change your batteries. I brought the voltage, as you can see, back up to around 3 volts. They haven't come back on, so let's just check if it needs a hard reset, reboot, and yeah, and then they're back. He says, let's put them on to... Yep, and then they're back and working. Okay, right, I've got the multimeter set up with two probes connected to mains. I've got my own little jig which I use to test mains. I've set it to the volt setting and I've set it onto AC. This is obviously on the Vici. I'm gonna switch on the power strip at the background. So there we go, it's showing the mains measurement. I'm now going to, let's say we want to see the frequency of the mains. Remember, the top one, in theory, I think is for logical signals only. We will come back to that. I switch hertz. And yeah, here in the States, obviously, we're at 60 hertz. So it's showing that duty cycle as showing roughly what the duty cycle is. So push that again. We come back to the voltage reading. I'm going to switch off the power strip. I'm going to flick it round to the other hertz, and it looks as though it's doing its magical esoteric thing by picking up the frequency already. Let me just pull out, I have got the power strip switched off. Let's just check. Yeah, it's obviously picking it up through, even though the power strip is off, it's picking it up through the cables. Ah, it's going a bit wonky now. Interesting. I'm going to switch the power on and hopefully nothing goes awry. No, in this case, it's even able to measure the mains frequency there. Okay, not a problem. Before I do any other testing, I'm going to disconnect this one. We'll put the Victor on the board. And again, and I didn't note, I must say, I didn't note when I took it apart to see. I presume it's just the moldings of the plastic which don't allow the sockets to go right down. But anyway, I get these in enough to take a measurement. I'm going to flick through to volts AC, switch on the power strip. We get our mains reading over there. Frequency, duty cycle, back to voltage. I'm going to switch off. Let's just see if it is overshoot. No, it seems to go straight there. Let's go to the logic side of it. And that is working there. So now the test is, what happens if I happen to have this switched on volts AC and I go to resistance? Will it die or do something naughty? I'm actually going to, because someone said something has gone awry, I'm actually going to put some eye protection on before I do this. Right, so here we go. I've got my eye protection here just for a laugh. Top tip, if you are a cyclist, you can pay hundreds of dollars for a pair of cycling glasses, but you can get these really cool looking, very functional eye protection glasses which work perfectly on a bicycle. But anyway, I'll put those on just in case. Let's see, we're on volts AC, and I'm going to flick through to the resistance. Can't smell anything. Come back. And that's worked okay. Now again, just a heads up, you shouldn't do that. The note, obviously you need to first select what you want to measure, then you insert your probes and take the measurement. Flicking through the dial while you're in here could be catastrophic. On some meters it has been for me anyway. Right, so let's try the Vichy. Right, so we're on the Vichy, we're on the voltage selection over there. It's set to DC by default. I'll switch on, flick over to AC. We've got a reading, resistance. Leave it there for a while. Come back. Okay, it's defaults to DC. Back to AC, and it still works. And again, I say you shouldn't do that, but it seems to have at least gone through that and not fallen over totally. Right, and just for a laugh, what I thought I'd do, I've connected up my Mastek insulation tester. This can go from 50 to 1000 volts. I'm putting it on the input, which is rated for 1000 volts DC. Now, obviously, just a heads up, the two fuses inside are rated for 250 volts, but they're obviously on the current side. Okay, so that's on the current measurement side, so they're not going to be affected by this test. But let's just see how it does handle. We'll start off with the 50 volts. It does 50 volts, okay. We'll step it up to the next level, which is 100 volts. I'll bring in a little bit closer just so you can see the actual settings on the meter itself, right? So 100, yeah, and it's managing to do that. 250, yep, it's managing that okay. Let's go to 500. Let's keep it down for a while, make sure it does cope. Yep. Remember, these are DC voltages which are being applied. Let's go to 1000. Oh, it's bleating. Interesting. I wonder if that's just an internal warning about it hitting a high level. But it's coped, so it's coped with 1000 volts input on the voltage measurement. Right, so I've got the Vichy connected up. I'm going to start off at 250 volts just so we don't have to waste too much time. There we go, 250 it handles. Let's go to 500. Let's keep it there for a little while. 500 it handles. We'll go up to 1000. Same warning, or same bleating, whether it's necessary, I presume it must be a warning. Let's keep it there for a while. And there you go. So it certainly does measure its rated 1000 volt DC input. Again, this is low energy. There's not much current involved in this tester. You do not want to be sitting out on any high energy circuit near those kind of voltages with this kind of multimeter. Just a heads up. I'm just doing it as a fun test over here for the review. Right, so there we go. How do we kind of sum it up? I think if we kind of look at the build quality, I would say that the Vichy is perhaps a little, the feeling of the selector switch and the internals might let it down a little bit compared to the Victor. I have gone and stuck a piece of wire in and actually measured the depth of the kind of banana sockets and discovered that the Victor is 3 to 5 mil shallower
than the Vichy. The Vichy is probably a standard depth, and I just think they've made them really shallow on the Victor, which obviously is the limitation in terms of putting normal plug or probes in here. So that for me unfortunately really lets us down. This does really well in the frequency measurement, as we noted. There are not many multimeters that I know of that kind of go up to 30 megahertz. I could obviously only test this up to 20, but even that's quite high. For the money, certainly, you know, the build quality obviously isn't that great. The input protection isn't that brilliant. I wouldn't use them on high energy circuits, even though I test them up to 1000 volts. I'd say for electronics on the bench as a quick throw around, or if you're really on a tight budget, then yeah, it's doable. So yes, for the money, I don't see how you can go wrong. Obviously your eyes have been open to all the bits and pieces, hopefully in the review on them. If you do gain any value, then please give us a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers. Tester.co.uk